This is why it's good, because you have a tight end, and this is the biggest matchup mismatch on the field when you have a good one, because you have a guy that's really a skilled player when you look at how the tight ends are developed today and what we're asking them to do, and they're going against guys, and I'm sorry, LeVar, but they're going against linebackers and safeties that really don't move well in space. There's only a few guys in the National Football League that can move side to side and really get it done week in and week out against some of the greatest tight ends in the league. So now you put him with Dak Prescott and all that firepower, this team will be unstoppable. Now, Coach, we know that this team has a big hole on the defensive side. They need a lot of help. That's probably one of the reasons why they're exploring. They're saying, you know what, instead of trying to go find more guys and more talent, let's put it in Dan Quinn's hand and let the scheme make up for the lack of talent. So Dan Quinn has his job cut out for him, but this Kyle Pitts, man, can come in and be a matchup nightmare and take this offense that was averaging almost 500 yards a game before Dak Prescott went down. This is scary. It reminds me of some of the great offenses that we've seen in the National Football League.
Yeah, Brandon, I don't know who made the more random reference, whether it was Jenna with Murphy Brown or the Sugar Plum reference. They were both, pretty far removed from what we're used to dealing with. I love tight ends. I know the value that they have for an offense and how difficult they are from a defensive perspective, because you've got to push so much coverage and you've got to make so many different decisions to deal with a good one. So I get that, and I understand the impact that would have on Dallas's offense. Now, that being said, this isn't college, and you're not recruiting. It's not like they're trying to convince him to come to Dallas. You get a chance to choose him, and typically in the NFL, you don't want to give away who you're in love with. And we've seen it happen in the past with New Orleans and Patrick Mahomes. It was a poorly kept secret that New Orleans loved Patrick Mahomes and they were going to draft him. And what did Kansas City do? They set up a trade with Buffalo. They jumped one spot ahead of him and they take Patrick. And it's, you know, it's one of those situations where if you just keep it quiet, you might have gotten the guy that you want. And now, you know, everybody knows how in love he is. And then if teams behind him want to jump up, they understand, you know, that's a line of demarcation. They're going to have to move in front of Dallas to get him.
Coach, I think that Jerry will send enough sugar plums to all of those would-be suitors that they will stay in their current draft positions because of the reward. That's first and foremost. Secondly, I love the decision. I love him jumping out there and saying, Cal Pitts, I want you to come here, because you know what? If Cal starts subscribing to it, which most people are some way, somehow fans of the Dallas Cowboys, so he may love it. He may talk about it. These things may hit. I don't know. But to me, I look at it like this. We keep saying tight end, all right? Tight end, tight end. I know you're aware of this guy, Coach Mangini. It's Plexico Burris's long lost child, cousin. I don't know what he is to. I don't know the relation. But when you look at the way he moves, when you look at his size, his body control, the way his presence, his catch radius, it looks just like Plex. And then we've been talking about this. I do a show with him. We were talking about this, and I had to ask him and call him to task. Is this a wrong comparison? And he actually agreed and said, listen, the one thing that defenses can do, they can neutralize speed. You can neutralize speed by alignment, by scheme, but it is almost impossible to neutralize size. So to me, Coach, I look at this, if you do this, your defense is going to be playing against offenses that are playing from behind. And this puts defenses in a better position to have success when you have an offense that would be able to score like they would adding a Pitts to their team.
Yeah, but you're going to have to score a lot of points if you don't address the problems that they've had defensively. And I agree with you. This is more of a receiver type than a true Y tight end, and that comes with some problems too. I don't think anybody's talked about his elite blocking in any of their assessments. Mm-hmm. Look, you can go extreme one way, and for a lot of years Indy did that. Indy paid the offense and drafted defense. You can build a team a lot of different ways. And if Dallas is gonna say, okay, we're gonna just outscore everybody, then great. And this is what you need to do. You need to just keep adding on those weapons. It just, you know, we all run into those hard days where the defense has got to bow up. And if you don't have the horses, it's tough.
Fair.
All right, Coach, I want to talk about love and regret, but, not our own. I'm just talking about football right now. Okay, so things that Jerry Jones loves. He loves stars. Loves stars. Star in the field, star in the helmet, stars all over the roster. He loves offense. When you look at how much money they spend on offense compared to defense, you can see what he values in a roster. So the idea of adding yet another offensive weapon to this makes sense. Now, are they going to go up and pull off a trade? Because I don't think Kyle Pitts is going to be there at 10 to add him to not the triplets. You would have the quintuplets at that point. And now I'm going to talk about regret, Coach. Because I still think that Jerry Jones regrets passing on Randy Moss. When you have a guy like a legendary guy that you said, you know what? Let's move on. So the question for you is this. Do you think that in this draft that falling in love with Kyle Pitts gets you at a certain level, but the specter of missing out on Kyle Pitts will be enough to push Jerry to make a trade to go get him?
I think with any draft, when you fall in love with one player, you could run into problems because it clouds your assessment. And you really want to be as objective as possible going into this process because incredible opportunities come up that you didn't necessarily anticipate. And if you're so locked in on one guy, outside of the quarterback position to me is different. But if you're just locked in on one guy, you can miss those opportunities. And if you're still hurting from the Randy Moss decision, that's like the sugar plum reference. That's a long, long time ago. And I understand he loves offense and he loves stars and all those things, but he also loves winning. He loves winning. And unfortunately, you have to win with three phases, not just one phase. True. And if your defense and special teams aren't very good, makes it hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it makes me wonder how much of this is Jerry thinking about the future as well, because you just doubled down on your quarterback. You finally paid Dak Prescott. And you have guys on that offensive line. You got the running back. You got wide receivers that you paying a big price for. So how long can you keep those guys? We know what's going on in Seattle with Russell Wilson. Russell Wilson complained about, you haven't invested in the offensive side. So this could be them looking at, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, now we have a CD Lamb. Now we have a Kyle Pitts that can carry us for the next 5 to 10 years, because I don't know how much longer Cooper would be there at that price tag. So something to look at.
I tend to look at this and I continue to think to myself, I start to think about that team with Kurt Warner, the greatest show on turf, where you had so many weapons and you lost the defense. The defense was considered to be a serviceable defense. I mean, it was anchored by London Fletcher, had guys like Kim Herring in the back, had guys like DeMarco Farr on the front, and Tyoka Jackson and those type of guys. But to me, I look at this Dallas defense, and yes, they have played poorly. Yes, they have underachieved. But personnel-wise, they're not horrible, guys. Like, they're not horrible. So, again, I almost feel as though maybe this needs to be stated that they have played poorly. They have underperformed. But are they really that far away from being a good defense? I would say let's wait and see how they play. Let's wait and see how they play, because they got good players.
LeVar, I agree with you. When you go back to the season and you look at why that team was struggling, the number one factor was Coach Nolan. Like, I had Coach Nolan a couple years. I think what he's been trying to do in the National Football League can be successful when you have like Ray Lewis and Ed Reed, and those guys have super duper IQ and they understand and they get it. But Coach Nolan at times does a little too much.
They're going to simplify
it. But simplify it.
Right.
That's right. But you got Coach Quinn coming in with the talent that you're talking about, that personnel. If you simplify it, we'll see a better defense. So, Coach, I don't know how you see it, but I've always felt like Coach Nolan's defenses, when I had him in Denver, I had him in Miami, he was always doing a lot, and sometimes our guys just didn't know where to be.
Yeah, Dallas wants to go back to what they had prior to Coach Nolan, and they want to simplify the defense. And Dan Quinn's going to do a great job with that, and those guys are going to play faster, and there's going to be improvement And I think all those things are going to help. I do think, though, at some point you've got to allocate enough resources to the defensive side to make them competitive. There's only one ball on offense. There's only you know, so many stars that can get so many chances and so many opportunities to make plays. The other side has to play too. And I think when you disproportionately spend one way or the other, you can get into problems.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from First Things First, or go watch a few segments from our other shows on FS1.